Hey buddies, Potato McWhiskey here and welcome to Let's Play Civilization 6 in the Gathering Storm June update. Now, today I'm going to be trying something a little bit different for a series. Usually what I try to do is I try to just play Deity and I try to beat it, kind of almost brute force, force my way to victory. But today we're going to be doing something a little bit different. I do actually have to make sure. This is something I run into a lot. My mods turn themselves on, and I do not want any mods active for this playthrough, because the goal of this playthrough is to teach people. And what we're going to be trying to teach people is how to, first of all, beat the game at a relatively low difficulty setting, but also to have fun along the way. And I think one of the things a lot of players do, and I'm speaking from experience here, because this is something I used to do when I would play the game, is I would set the game to like settler difficulty, and then I would make the largest possible map, and I would cram as many civs in as possible, and I would pick some crazy settings. And I think that can be a really fun and interesting way to play. And if you enjoy that way, go ahead and keep doing that. But I really think when you're just new to the game, here's what I'm going to recommend you do. I recommend you play on Prince or Warlord, okay? Play on Prince, play on the standard difficulty setting, okay? And I'm also going to recommend you just play on a small map. One of the things about playing on a huge map is it slows the game down for a number of reasons. First of all, you're competing against more people, so it's more likely that someone will make it harder for you to win. You are also sort of imbalancing the map a little bit by changing how things work. And you also kind of end up in a state where if you're going for any kind of domination where you want to kill people, you just make that really tedious and arduous for yourself. So I recommend, you know, just play on a small map, play on Prince or something like that, and just go ahead. Now, don't be afraid to pick a civ. I'm going to do a random civ today because the civ I play doesn't matter. And we'll talk about it in a minute. But I really think you should just play on standard settings. Really, honestly, if you're a new player and you're trying to figure out how to enjoy Civilization 6 and how to have fun and how to get better, the only setting you should change is the map setting and the civ that you're playing. Leave everything else completely vanilla, completely standard. Don't change any of these settings, because the reason for this is these default settings are what you're going to play when you click play now, right? When you or if you click create game and you stay in standard setup, these are the settings you're going to play. So like, think within these bounds, okay? Like, you can play with a disaster intensity and stuff like that. And the Civilization 6 developers know this, right? So the game is going to be most balanced and designed around players who play like this. And that's really, really important. And that's why you see often in my games, I usually only go up to standard or small. I don't make bigger games, I typically, because the game is built and designed around playing this way. And you might not agree with that. You could play with mods and all that sort of stuff, but there's a reason. The reason you should play about this is because the game is built to be played this way, right? That, now don't get me wrong, they do test, you know, they test Marathon game speed, they test Epic game speed to make sure it all works. But the majority of design and focus and energy is going to be around these sort of standard settings. Is the game fun with these standard settings? You can, of course, change the map, but we're just going to play completely standard, right? So that's one of the most important things about enjoying the game. It's just, don't implement a whole bunch of crazy settings. Because what I used to do when I was getting into Civ 5 back in the day and Civ 4 is I used to pick these wacky settings and play really crazy maps, and I would play weird civs and I would just kind of amble about. And I wouldn't go anywhere and I wouldn't have a good time. I would have a good time for the early game, because the early game in Civilization is the most fun part of the game. But then I would realize that I'm into the mid game and my game has no direction, and you know, the settings I've picked are kind of hindering me and all that sort of stuff. So that's why you should just, if you're trying to learn how to play the game and enjoy the game, just play on the bog standard settings. And then the next thing to do is, honestly, just pick a random civ. So I've rolled Scythia here, and this is going to be like offering a puzzle to me. Is, you know, within the bounds of what I encounter, how do I like set a goal and how do I achieve a goal in a game of Civilization 6? So we could talk about Scythia, right? Scythia's bonuses. And the civilization's bonuses are going to be like the primary factor in like informing what your sort of strategic top layer game plan is. So you can see here, I have the Killer of Cyrus. So my units get +5 combat strength when they're attacking wounded units. And when they eliminate a unit, they heal up to 30 hit points. I also have the People of the Steppe, which means I get a second light cavalry unit or sack of horse archer each time I train a light cavalry unit or a sack of horse archer. I also have the Sack of Horse Archer, which is a unique classical era unit with 4 movement and a range of 1. And I also get the Kurgan, which is a unique tile improvement that gives me faith, gold, and faith for each adjacent pasture. So how do I parse all this information? Well, I look at these bonuses, okay? I get extra combat strength when I'm attacking wounded units. So that tells me that maybe some sort of aggression is involved. And if I heal up to 30 hit points, that means, again, some sort of aggression is going to be involved. Also, I get essentially what is a production bonus, right? If I build a light cavalry unit and get 2 of them, that is in essence a 100% production bonus. So that's going to inform me and tell me that I want to push towards a militaristic game. And with that framework sort of in my head, now I have to start asking questions to the game. I'm like, okay, I know I want to go for some sort of militaristic game. How do I do that? What are the things that I can do that push me in that direction and help me further my goals, right? And I haven't even made a move yet, right? But I know my plan is to be aggressive. So I need to start asking questions of where do I want to settle, right? So where do I want to settle? What settlement will sort of give me a strong early game to feed into an aggressive game plan? And one of the ways you can do that is by making sure you scout with your warrior first so you can get an idea of the land that's around. And really what you're looking for is a good mixture of food and production and resources to work, right? One of the top things you're going to be looking for too is one of these. This is a Plains Hill. Also, if you are struggling with the visuals of the game, don't be afraid to play on the strategic view map mode. This can also be helpful if your computer is not very strong in the graphical department. It can make it just a little bit easier to play because it kind of flattens everything and you can kind of play it almost like a board game. So don't be afraid to do that if you need to. I like to play it in this mode because I'm just used to it, really. For example, if I look at this hill, this is a Plains Hill, and this is a unique tile. This is a piece of information the game just doesn't tell you. But if you settle a city on a Plains Hill, you'll get +1 production in your capital city, right? Because every time you settle a city, it conforms the production, the yield value to 2 food, 1 production, and anything over that is kept. So for example, if I settle on a 1 food, 2 production tile, it will increase the food to 2, but it won't decrease the production down. Similarly, if I were to settle on this jade, it would keep the food the same because it's already 2, it would add 1 production, and then it would keep the culture, which would mean basically from the start of the game I get +1 culture, which is really interesting on my capital city tile. And normally this tile wouldn't be really justifiable to work because it's only 2 food, 1 production, because in the early game you want lots of food and lots of production to keep your empire going. So in the interest of making sure that we're playing optimally, we're going to settle on this Plains Hill because it's just a natural benefit. And even if you can, I would say somewhere in the region of 2 to 3 turns to move to a Plains Hill is okay if that location also has other advantages. So some of the things you might consider is it's on a river. This is on the river. It's not very far away. It has workable resources within a reasonable range. I would say 1 tile is great. 2 tiles away is an okay distance for things to be, and anything 3 tiles out is kind of getting sketchy in terms of whether or not you're going to be able to reach it. And another this is something we'll talk about when we're settling, actually. And so you just pick the tile you want to settle, and we'll talk a little bit more about sort of advancing through the game. So keeping what we have in mind, right, we want to go for an aggressive game. We want to go for some kind of battle plan where we take out the enemy, and we're presented with a whole host of options here in our capital city. And this is actually kind of difficult, because one of the troubles that a player is going to have when they're playing Civilization 6 is there's going to be a lot of options given to the player, but they don't really have the knowledge or potentially even the tools to know which ones are good moves, right? So for example, we have the ability to build a monument, a builder, a scout, a warrior, and a slinger. And all of these have outcomes, but a new player doesn't know what those outcomes are or whether they're good. And that's why it's okay to just kind of try them. Just try them. Now, we already have a game plan, right? Our game plan is to be aggressive. So that, to me, pushes me in the direction of I either want to build units to... I want to build units to scout the enemy or attack the enemy. And I don't think I want to build units to attack the enemy because I am Tamiris and I get a bonus towards light cavalry where I can produce more of them. So maybe I would be better off delaying my attack until I have unlocked light cavalry like horseman or the Saka archer, horse archer, and then attack my opponent, right? So I don't need to go for units right now, but I can go for them later on. So that tells me maybe I want to get a scout because I can't attack someone if I don't know where they are, right? That's a logical train of thought. In terms of scouting information, you're going to want to take your cues from the land around you. So, what do I mean by that? So, one thing you can do is pull your camera up and pull your camera down, because oftentimes you can actually see the end of the map. So, if I come up here, I can kind of turn and I can see, look, if you look up here in the top right-hand corner of the screen, as I turn, you can see that's the top end of the map. You hold down Alt key and then left click and drag, and you can kind of rotate the camera. And so, I can see up there that the north of the map is there, but I can't actually see the south end of the map by turning my camera. So that tells me I'm a little bit north of the sort of quote-unquote equator of this world map that I'm on, right? So that's a little bit of information gathering that you can do. And since I'm north of the equator, I know that there's going to be less land to explore to the north, but I also know that that land might be where I want to settle. So what I'm going to do is use my scout to scout north and use my warrior to scout south and west slightly. And the reason I'm scouting south and west is just because this is the furthest my warrior can move. You want to try, when you're scouting, you want to try to walk through the most open terrain you can. Now, I could have went north with this, but a scout will much more easily cover open terrain than a warrior. Whereas a warrior and scout can kind of roughly go across rough terrain at the same rate. So let's talk about opening technology. So we know that we want to be aggressive and we know we want to use light cavalry. And that's going to inform our decision making with regards to how we want to approach our technology tree. You can see here this unlocks horses. It also unlocks our unique tile improvement, the Kurgan, which gives us golden faith. So this tells me I want to unlock animal husbandry because this will reveal horses, which is a strategic resource that I can use to build a unit to be aggressive with. This is sort of how you just look at the options you have and then ask yourself, which of these options feeds into my game plan? And right now, I need to know where the resources are to make my game plan work. And so that's the major decision making that we need to make for quite a few turns. And now we can just kind of make decisions about how we scout. I think I'm going to scout in this forest. It looks like we've revealed another sort of area of forest, and I'm going to keep just scouting in this direction. And now we need to make a decision about where we want to go next. I think I'm going to go here and then to one of these two hills. Hills are important when you're scouting because hills actually increase the range that your units can see. So I've made it quite far from my home. And it looks like there's a scout here. I'm not going to attack that scout because I want to know more about the world. And by stepping up here, I see that there's actually a... this is something else you could do. You could see there's a little bit of a border here. And that tells me there is a city-state in the area because it is a dashed line border. Another way that you can actually find this information is by going into your lenses over here and clicking on the settler map mode. And by clicking on this, you can see these red tiles. That tells me there is a settled city here. And typically that's going to be a city state in the early game. You can also press 4 on your keyboard to just quickly access that. So that tells me my next turn, I'm going to want to stand here to meet this city state and then head back up to get this tribal village. Because the scout isn't really a big concern right now. If a whole bunch of barbarians spawn, it's not a big deal, right? Because we have no infrastructure for them to kill. If we had districts built, if we had tile improvements built, then we would be a little bit more wary of the scouts. So I'm going to go step one tile to the left. And there's Hattusa. And so now we want to make a decision about, well, what are we going to do with Hattusa this game? So Hattusa is a scientific city-state. Let's go ahead and talk to Hattusa. Up here in the top right-hand corner is the city-states button. And we're going to just look at them, right? This is Hattusa. It's a scientific city-state. You can tell because it's blue. It has a quest to give me a Eureka for irrigation. Now, if you're not sure where technology is, just go ahead and type into the Civilopedia up here the name of the thing that the city-state wants you to do. And I can see here that irrigation is a technology that is in the ancient era and it requires pottery. And it also tells me the boost is to farm a resource. So I know in order to get this quest done, all I have to do is farm a resource without ever having to look at the tech tree and find where this is. It's right here if you're curious, because there's pottery and pottery leads into irrigation, right? So just by using the tools that the game gave you, you can actually find out a lot of the information that you need to start making decisions. Hattusa is giving me 2 science per turn in my capital city because I was the very first person to meet them. And, you know, that's nice, because that's going to be leading in towards me getting animal husbandry unlocked a little bit earlier, which will make me be able to see where horses are on the map a couple of turns sooner. So now I have to make a decision about where I'm going to scout with my scout. So I can kind of tilt the screen again. I can see that there's actually a lot of room to my south. But I want to know, and this is important, I want to know if there's anyone behind me to the north, right? So I'm going to send my scout out nice and slowly and nice and easy, just kind of walking in whatever looks like the easiest terrain to walk through. Now, we've finished a scout, and once you finish a scout, you have to make a decision about what's your next unit. Well, we still don't know where anybody is, right? We found Hattusa, so maybe it would be a good idea to get another scout and find more information, because we could find more of these tribal villages. Scouts are really, really good in the early game. I would recommend like 1 to 2 scouts is a good amount to get. You don't need more than that. Typically, you can add a couple of scouts if it's a really big map and you just want to find out more, you know, stuff faster. But I would say 2 scouts and your warrior scouting is really, really nice. So we picked up that tribal village by walking up onto it, and we discovered a nice cache of gold. So now what do I want to do with my warrior? Well, I've already done a little bit of scouting my warrior. I found a city-state and a tribal village. And I also saw a scout, a barbarian scout down here. That was that red unit. So I know that somewhere in this region, sort of in this direction, if I imagine there's a direction and then like a cone, somewhere in this direction, there could be a barbarian encampment. Because I've seen all this area over here, so there's unlikely that there's a barbarian encampment in this area, because I can see all that. And I'm just going to tell my barbarian to walk to where the last place I saw that scout is, because there's a good chance that we'll see that scout there again. And this is another cool trick that you can use with your scouts over here, right? If I look here, I can kind of actually get an idea of what the terrain looks like. Scouts have 3 movement, and if I hover over these tiles, you can see that they cost 2 movement to go into. But you can kind of see that there's these little blue borders that tell you how far your scout can move in a single turn. And it actually applies to looking into the fog of war. So I know that this tile over here is a flatland tile, because I should be able to walk up here and into there without it costing me movement. So you can kind of get an idea of what's in the fog of war just by interpreting your scout's borders. I know for a fact that I could reveal the most information about the map by walking up, and then up left, right? So if I walk this way, I reveal the most possible amount of information. And I see that there's a really nice mountain range here. This tells me I'm not going to be attacked from the north. And every time I reveal new information, I'm going to want to just hit my settler key. To see if I spot any red tiles. Mountains don't count because you can't settle on them anyway, but I want to just kind of have a peek and see, do I see any more red tiles that tell me there might be another city around?
If there are no dogs in heaven,
there is the research for animal husbandry.
I want to go where they went.
And we found some horses down over here. These horses are a little bit far away. Now, if you're a new player, one of the things that can feel a little bit overwhelming is when you go to manage your city, you don't know what tiles to work. And I would say just in the early game, you're going to want to have a surplus of food. So if you click on this button over here, you want to have at least a surplus of 2 food. Working this production tile, while it is a lot of production, it's just not as valuable as having a surplus of at least two food, because the difference in growth time, right, if I let it work here, is 20 turns to get my third population, whereas if I work this tile, it's only 10 turns. And it doesn't matter which one of these it is. I could alternatively do something like this. I could work this tile, which loses me one production, but gains me one food. And this is, you can kind of do kind of like tile accounting is maybe a good way to describe it, is you just count up the total yields of two tiles. So if I go 1, 2, 3 food and 1, 2, 3, 4 production. So this is 3 food, 4 production, right? Across two tiles. Whereas if I work these two, this is 4 food, 2 production. But if I work this marsh right here, this is 3 food plus 1 food. So that's 4 food plus 3 production. So actually working this marsh and this deer is slightly better than working these two food, one production tiles, because I'm ending up with an extra piece of production, which is quite nice, right? It's just like a free chunk of production that I'm not otherwise getting just by carefully manipulating my stuff. And you just want to have that +2 food surplus in the early game because it gives you a reasonable growth trajectory. Going below +2 food sucks, basically, because your population grows so slowly. And in the early game, your population grows much faster than in the later stages of the game. So you want to grow them really, really quickly so that you can get them up and running and working tiles for you, essentially providing a return on investment. So I was scouted by a scout. Don't panic about that, right? All it's going to mean is that I might have to build an extra unit or two. That's all it means. So we're going to pop in here and pick up this tribal village. And looks like we got the boost towards craftsmanship. That's pretty nice. So we've already unlocked animal husbandry. And we want to start asking questions like, okay, how do I get to horseback riding? Well, or how do I achieve my goal of killing someone? Well, I haven't met anyone that I want to kill, right? I haven't found my target of my domination. And another way to do that is by getting encampments, right? So I know that encampments are the war themed. I don't need to know anything at all about how these encampments work. I just know that encampments are good for war. So maybe I should start heading towards encampments before I go for horsemen, because bronze working also reveals iron for me. And it'll also give me time to maybe get a slinger and get the boost for archery in the meantime. And these are the sort of decision-making processes that you're going to want to just kind of go through as you're playing the game. And I can see that the scout is actually going a bit of a weird direction to where it's not like fully scouting me. So I found that there's not really any way for me to keep scouting up this way, so I'm going to scout around this way. I'm pretty confident there's nothing up to the left here. And the reason for that is I see a bunch of water here. It maybe would have been worth it to scout this to check if this is a lake. If this is a lake, it would mean that there would be a land passage around here. But it's most likely because of the angle, right? You look at the angle of the coastline, that this is actual coastline. Typically, actually, you would want to look for a cliff to kind of confirm that. So actually, not seeing any cliffs at all kind of maybe suggests that that is a lake. But yeah, you're gonna want to take your cues for playing the game through just the information that it presents to you. Okay, wow. That is a little bit of a weird mountain range. So now that I have my second scout, I have to kind of question where I want to scout next. Now, I've maybe identified this as a lake, and there's also another scout up here, a barbarian scout. So what I'm going to do is head up this direction to see if I can kind of just confirm if this is a lake or not while I was trying to bring this scout down this way. Looks like I found another tribal village. And so now I need to make my next decision. Since I'm going to want to be going for an aggressive game, I'm going to want to see if I can get the archery boost and the bronze working boost, which tells me I might want to build some military units, right? Because I'm trying to get these technology boosts, which will help me get to my win condition sooner. And this is a reasonable thing to do, is to just attack an enemy scout, right? Just attack a barb scout, it'll hurt it, and it'll make it easier to chase down with your slinger later. And we're just going to slowly make our way over towards this tribal village as well. When you find yourself, I'm going to tell this scout to fortify, because this scout is attacking me. I'm going to tell it to fortify on this hill. Use the hill as a defense, so that this scout takes a little bit more damage and I take a little bit less. And also, I don't want this scout to kill this. I don't want my scout to kill the barbarian scout, because I'd like to kill this scout over here with my slinger so that I can get the boost for archery. Every time you do a Eureka, which is this boost down here at the bottom, it'll give you 40% of the technology science. So killing this barb scout with a slinger is worth essentially 20 science, and I'm getting 5 science per turn, so that's 4 turns worth of science at this point in the game. That's a pretty reasonable amount. So I'm going to go ahead and pick up... I'm going to start working towards archery, but I'm going to try to not finish the technology. And we'll talk about that as we go on. Go ahead and pick this up. Looks like we got the boost for irrigation, and that's actually pretty cool because that gives us +1 envoy for Hattusa. If you remember, Hattusa had the mission for us to get the irrigation technology. I'm just going to head down here. It looks like the Barb Scout attacked me again, and in order to prevent this Barbarian Scout accidentally killing itself on my Scout, I'm going to just spend a turn, hide my Scout in my city, and hopefully this Barb Scout won't attack me. There's a lake up here. And so we just finished our first civic here, Code of Laws. And so now we need to make a decision about, well, what's our next step? Well, we could see that our goal is to kill some Barbarian units for the purpose of... our goal is to kill some Barbarian units for the purpose of getting technology boosts. So I think we are going to want to take discipline here so that our units do more damage against Barbarian units. We're also going to want to pick up urban planning, because our goal is to produce more units to kill Barbarians. And we also, as Scythia, have already a way to generate faith to get a pantheon, right? So we don't need to do God King. We can do urban planning and discipline. And I would say in like most of your games, you would be perfectly fine plopping in both of these and being perfectly happy going about your day. So now that we finished our first civic, what are our goals here? Like, well, our goal is to build an army to kill someone. So I think that kind of pushes me in the direction of grabbing craftsmanship, because there's a card here, right? Agage or Agog, which gives me +50% production towards ancient and classical era melee, anti-cavalry and range units. So I'm going to go ahead and work on picking up craftsmanship, because that's going to let me build an army more efficiently that I might kill some of these barbarians with. Okay, so it looks like, unfortunately, that scout decided to kill himself on my city, which really, really sucks. There's also another scout passing by me here. So what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to attack it with my warrior for the purpose of softening it up in case it runs up towards my slinger. My slinger will have an easier time killing this scout for the boost towards archery. And we'll just continue to scout with this guy. I'm just trying to find any sort of open terrain I can send this scout into. This scout up here is a little bit too hurt, so I'm going to tell him it's just fortify until you're healed, and then I'll go ahead and give you orders. I'm going to go ahead and pick up another warrior. It's often a good idea to get two to three warriors total, so building 1 to 2 warriors in the early game, just to protect you against barbarians. Like, there's a barb camp over here that I'll need to kill, and so stuff like that. So just keep that kind of in mind. And you can see he ran in the direction of my slinger, and so I'm hoping to get him to come, like, walk past my slinger or step somewhere where he can't escape so my slinger can kill him. And then we're going to look for the barb camp. So it looks like we have found the barb camp that we're going to want to try and take out. Oh, and it looks like we have found the borders of another city-state. So if we press 4 to go into the settler map mode, we can see that there is red tiles here on what should be settlable tiles, which means that the barbarian encampment or the city is over here that we can go meet. And we can tell by the color that this is a militaristic city-state, which is very good. So one really interesting thing about barbarian encampments is that if they see a slinger, if a spearman sees a slinger, the spearman thinks, I can kill that slinger, and so it will try to chase it down. The spearman will most likely try to come out of the camp here. So what I want to do is I want to try and box this scout in so that I can get the kill. And up here I can see an archery, and this is just something you have to like learn to check every turn. I can see that the bar for the boost has essentially filled the rest of the technology. There's a very slight gap there, but that's okay. And you can kind of see this if I look at irrigation, this is filled, right? So I know that I can actually switch away from archery and not waste any technology and start working on bronze working. And I do plan on killing more barbarian units, so that's a perfectly reasonable thing to do, right? Because I know I'm going to finish archery by killing a barb with my slinger, because that's my objective. And you can see the barbarian spearman came out to attack my slinger. So I'm going to go ahead and kill the barb camp, which will give me error score. It'll also give me gold that I might be able to turn into a builder, for example. Or I might be able to buy tiles. I could buy this horse tile, for example. In fact, I could go as far as... Ah, that is annoying. I was hoping to get that kill there. It looks like we've met a cod. And we just go up here to the city-state map mode. If you meet a city-state and then this number says zero, that means that this city-state has met another player. Another, like, real sort of civilization. A player who is leading a civilization. And that can be very informative. Because I know if I draw a line between where I am and this city, based on what I can see on the map, I know that there's very likely to be another player in sort of this arc, right? Because there is a sort of valley of unknown information, right? But I know there's no player down this direction, or there's very unlikely to be a player up in this direction because I can see all the settling information. But I know for a fact that the player is somewhere in this sort of a arc, right? Somewhere in this region. And I'm going to want to meet that player because who the player is going to dictate how you approach killing them. And because the scout attacked our slinger, that actually gave us the boost for the archery technology, because it doesn't matter if your unit kills, if your unit is the attacker or the defender, it just matters that it was an archer that killed it. That actually wasn't how it used to work. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to move this slinger down into the flat ground to attack this spearman, because if you look here, he has a strength of 26. That means he's going to do a little bit of damage to our warrior, right? But if I attack with the slinger, I could pretty much get this kill by attacking with the warrior, right? But if I attack with the slinger first, I lower his health, which means he has an attack strength of 23 now, which means my warrior takes less damage. My warrior will actually get the kill and heal. And bada bing, bada boom. I lost 22 health. So that was a net of 8 health, right? Whereas before it wasn't going to get the kill. And that's pretty cool. And I also know where there's another barb camp, so I'm going to send this warrior out to go sort of make his way over there and see if he can start cleaning that up. And I'll probably bring my slinger back to also help with that while I send this warrior to just kind of have a look around this area over here. So now that you have like 2 scouts, maybe 3 scouts, a slinger and 2 warriors, you can actually ask yourself, do I want to settle a city really early? Or do I perhaps want to work on something else? Do I want to get more units? And since we are Scythia, and we are going to want to build light cavalry, which means we're not going to want to spam these kind of like low tier units. We're going to go ahead and work on getting a settler. So how do we identify where good settling spots are? And how do we like kind of contain our settling strategy? Well, there's one thing a lot of really, really new players do. Is they'll try to, so let's say we take Pokrovka, and we can see that Pokrovka can actually work tiles up to like up to 3 tiles away. So Pokrovka can work this tile, and this tile, and that applies all the way around. A big sort of mental hurdle that new players need to get over is that a city is never going to work all of the tiles that are in range. Cities just don't get big enough, and they don't grow enough. So it's actually good and desirable to have some overlap, right? Typically, you're going to want to overlap the third ring quite a lot, because it's very unlikely that you're going to work the third ring in your city, because the city grows to the second ring first. You might work maybe 2 to 3 of the third ring tiles. So an example of that will be in Pokrovka. I might work the horses here, the sheep here, and the jade. And the stone, right? But all these other tiles, they would be better in the hands of another city. So it would be perfectly fine to settle like right on the border, because I know for a fact that Pokrovka isn't going to work most of these tiles. So I don't need to settle a city like all the way out over here, like as far away as possible to maximize how many tiles it grabs. It's actually perfectly fine to settle, say, for example, right here on the tobacco, or maybe right here. If I settle right here, that's one less tile that Pokrovka has to work in its outer ring, and I can get a value from this stone really, really early. Now, in this example, what I'm going to do is I'm going to be settling on this tobacco, and we'll talk about why why we would do this. So why would we settle on a luxury? There's quite a few reasons you're going to want to settle on a luxury in a game of Civilization VI. So the first reason you're going to settle on it is the luxury tile isn't very good. And what does that mean? It means that the actual act of telling a worker to work this tile is not very good. Like, if I were to tell a citizen to work this 2 food, 1 production, 1 faith tile, that is not very valuable in comparison to a horse tile, which is 3 food, 1 production, and then can be improved to like 4 food, 1 production, or 3 food, 2 production, or this quarry, which could be 2 food, 3 production if I put a quarry on this stone tile, right? So identifying that a tile is not very desirable to work, and there are other desirable tiles to work, like this 2 food, 2 production tile, this 2 food, 2 production tile, this 2 food, 2 production tile, this horse tile, this jade here, potentially, because it gives culture, and culture is quite valuable. So by identifying that we don't want to work this tile with a citizen, and that it's on fresh water, and it has like all the qualities that we would like to settle a city on, we actually want to settle on the tobacco, because it's going to give us, in addition to all those other things, if you settle on a luxury, you actually just straight up get access to that luxury, and we don't actually have to research irrigation to get access to it, right? Whereas if we settled off of this luxury, we would settle like, say, here, we would have to wait until we research irrigation, which would slow down how quickly we get our horseback riding, how quickly we get bronze working, all that sort of stuff. And that would mean we wouldn't actually be getting the benefit of this tobacco for quite a long time. So that's why you're going to want to settle on a luxury resource. Anyway, I'm going to call that there for this first episode. I hope you guys are enjoying this series so far. This is something a little bit different, because I get asked these sorts of questions all the time. It's like, how do you play Civ? How do you get into Civ? And that's why we're going to run through essentially what is a Prince game, right? This is a Prince game, and I'm going to try and give you my thoughts and about what I'm doing and why I'm doing things, because I often don't really... When I'm playing, I'm acting on instinct from like a couple thousand hours of playing, right? And so this series is about trying to extract that knowledge into a distilled form and then give it to players so that they can better understand my thought process and better understand how they should go about decision-making in a game of Civilization VI. Anyway, I love you all very much, and I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.